Why are there no animals with wheels? What are the limits of evolution? Are there forbidden designs? If we would wish to use evolutionary processes to optimize our own designs, then we must better understand what natural selection and evolution can and can't achieve. We must better understand the limits of evolution. So let's start with the simple question. Why have animals never evolved wheels? Yes, it's true that many animals can roll themselves up into a ball, such as armadillos and woodlice, but none have ever evolved wheels, structures that can rotate in one direction without limits, on an axle. There are two obvious reasons why this might be the case. First, expanses of flat land suitable for wheels to travel are rare in nature, such that humans have had to expend countless time and effort building roads. Limbs are just more versatile across more terrains. Second, a wheel must be separate from its axle if it is to rotate without limits. However, a separated appendage can't receive blood, nutrients, oxygen. Any amputated limb will quickly turn grey and die. But neither of these reasons are absolutely watertight. Humans have invented many off-roading wheeled vehicles, and most can move faster across the land than any living thing on Earth. Perhaps a wheeled animal would be at great advantage on, for example, the grasslands of the Serengeti, able to chase down a gazelle faster than any cheetah. As for a separated appendage, mammals have already solved that problem with horns, nails and hair, all just structured outgrowths of keratin. Your hair can fall out, so what is stopping an animal from growing then detaching a keratin wheel? We could argue about the pros and cons of wheels for a while, but the fact remains, animals have never evolved them. And the reasons for this must logically fall into two categories. Number one, functional constraints, and number two, developmental constraints. Functional constraints are easy to imagine. For a well-studied example of functional constraints, we can look at the shell of the ammonoids, extinct ancestors of modern-day squid, octopus and cuttlefish that thrived during the age of the dinosaurs. Why did some shapes of shell evolve while others were seemingly forbidden? To explore this, we can generate what's called a theoretical morphospace for the shell of the ammonoids. A morphospace is the space of all possible designs for a life form, produced by systematically varying the parameters of a geometric model. In this case, you can vary the whirl expansion rate of the shell, W, and you can vary the distance from the coiling axis to the aperture of the shell, D. If you do that, as the biologist David Raup did in 1967, you get a kind of graph showing the space of all possible shell designs. If you then look through all the known fossils of ammonoids, you will find that only the shell geometries within these boundaries actually evolved. And yet, all of the other shell designs are geometrically possible. They were just never used. Why? Well, an answer would surface in 1981 when another researcher, John Chamberlain Jr., decided to measure the flow of water around model shells to assess their streamlining and so come up with a swimming efficiency coefficient, or SEC. He found that all of the shells actually evolved by ammonoids have a minimum SEC of 40. He had found an actual limit of evolution. It turns out that similar limits can be found for the shells of all mollusks, despite their half a billion years of evolutionary history. And there are surely other constraints that limit how such shells can grow. These functional constraints are easy to test. As for the developmental constraints, they would be the shells that are geometrically impossible, and so can't be grown by a mollusk or anything. Shells which you therefore can't test. However, most limits of evolution are probably a different subset of developmental constraints. The category of phylogenetic constraints. You can only make so much from whatever you start off with. In other words, the embryo of a raven is fewer random mutations away from developing into a crow than, say, a swordfish. So, if we want to look at phylogenetic constraints, we must look at the evolutionary history, the lineage of an organism. The key principle to remember is that every stage in a creature's evolution must be better than the stage that came before it. That's the point of evolution. It's an algorithm for optimization. In this case, optimizing the ability of an organism to survive, known as its fitness. We can chart the increase of a lineage's fitness over time, and it should look roughly like this. Evolution is just our name for these changes over time that increase fitness. We can go one step further and graph fitness across a 3D morphospace, a landscape representing all the possible designs a life form might take. This is the fitness landscape, an idea introduced by Sewall Wright in 1932. So the hills represent good designs, and the troughs represent bad designs. Then we can show how a particular lineage of animal has climbed one of these mountains of fitness. Now, obviously, the fitness landscape is not a static thing and changes depending on the environmental conditions, among other things. but it is a useful model that helps us understand evolution and, of course, the designs that have never been seen in nature, like the wheel. It might be that the wheel is greatly advantageous to survival, but that this fitness peak is surrounded by a deep valley that is extremely difficult to traverse. As I said, every stage in evolution must be better than the one that came before it, so you can climb up the mountain, but never downwards. And it might even just be the case that wheels are rubbish. What about other seemingly forbidden designs? There are no other features that have never evolved in any organism on Earth, but there are features that have never evolved in particular lineages. One mystery is why live-bearing has never evolved in birds and turtles. After all, there are live-bearing fish and reptiles, but birds and turtles exclusively lay eggs. It seems unlikely that any single avian feature is incompatible with live-bearing, so perhaps they have reached what is known as a local maximum. In other words, they have climbed a small peak and are now stranded there. Their anatomy is simply too well adapted to egg-laying, such that any changes in the direction of live-bearing, any intermediate stage, would be less fit. As I've said, decreasing fitness is forbidden by evolution. You can only go up, never down. So that's what most developmental constraints probably look like. Now, what happens when we put all of these constraints together? If we take a fitness landscape and look at the number of species in a lineage that have occupied each region, we find that the highest number of species tends to be at the start of the lineage and lower down in the fitness landscape. In other words, the greatest disparity between different designs, which you can measure using a number of indices, tends to be earlier on. Then, over time, as the lineage climbs the mountain of fitness, the number of occupied designs decreases, disparity decreases, and we end up with lots of well-adapted animals that all look the same, known as homoplasy. The reason for this convergence is, at least in many cases, the existence of constraints. We've spoken about geometric, physical, environmental, and developmental constraints, and all of these constraints exist in constant flux. A sudden extinction event can dramatically change the fitness landscape, whereby animals previously at the top of the mountain suddenly find themselves deep in a valley, and vice versa. A lineage of animals can suddenly find themselves without any competition, the key ecological constraints, and so find themselves free to explore a suddenly unoccupied morphospace. This is why extinction events often result in a massive diversification. For example, the extinction of the dinosaurs is famously said to have allowed mammals to diversify into the great variety we see today. In fact, over a long time, multiple extinctions might whittle away the occupied regions of morphospace, leaving increasingly large and unbridgeable morphological gaps between the remaining groups. So, looking at the incredible variety of life we see today, and indeed in the fossil record, one might be tempted to ask, is that everything now? Given what we know about convergent evolution, will we ever see anything truly new again? The famous evolutionary biologist Stephen Jay Gould believed that what we see today is, to quote him, just a subset of workable but basically fortuitous survivals among a much larger set that could have functioned just as well but either never arose or lost their opportunities by historical happenstance. Was he right? Perhaps all life on Earth has, from very early on, been stranded on a local maximum, and life on Earth is hence doomed never to explore other mountains of fitness that might otherwise be occupied by alien life on other planets. Or it might be that the convergent evolution we see in the fossil record plays out again and again and again, such that the same basic body designs dominate throughout the universe. And that is the old question I will leave you to think about. If we ran the tape of life on Earth, how similarly would things turn out the same way?